Hi guys, I'm Stephen Lowe, the author of Overcoming Gravity, and today we'll be going through Overcoming Gravity Online, Part 17, and in Part 17, we're covering Part 4, getting into the first part of Part 4, Program Implementation, and Chapter 17 covers the Untrained Beginner Routine Construction and Implementation. So in this, we're basically going to go through all of the various parts of a routine and how they all fit together. This is basically similar to the sample routine I gave in chapter 5, I believe, or part 5 of this series. And we're going to go through all those different parts and why those parts fit together. So this is just an example. You aren't actually supposed to use this for training. And so you can, according to your goals, you can use this as a template for modification for your specific routine that you want to construct for yourself. Or in general, I guess you could use it as a generalized beginner routine if you wanted to start with it. And then as you learn more and experience more, you can modify things as necessary to fit your goals more. All right, so let's get into things. All right, so the untrained beginner, their general needs are basic exercises and to become more proficient with them. Also to utilize higher rep ranges for connective tissue conditioning. Obviously with untrained beginners, not familiar with exercise for the most part, and so they're more liable to get connective tissue injuries like overuse tendinopathy and things like that, and various joint soreness. Also address potential lifestyle weaknesses such as posture. Remember, there's no such thing as good posture, but there can be problematic postures such as, you know, head forward and shoulders rounded, where you're putting more stress on the tissues than more of a normal posture standing up. Also getting into a balanced routine and making sure there aren't any issues with emphasizing more muscle groups than others. So some sample goals are skills such as a 10-second handstand with push and pull, working towards planche and muscle-ups and front lever. Overall, also working towards some leg goals and core goals such as single-leg squats and V-sit. So obviously these can all vary depending on what your goals are. The routine in general is structured towards working towards these goals. But if you have multiple goals, like many more than this in each category, such as for like push, you have some dipping goals, you know, planche goals in the long run, Maltese, handstand push-ups, and so on. Obviously, you want to narrow those down to like 1 to 2 to work on at a time. All right, so warm-up and skill work. Generally speaking, the blood flow portion of the warm-up is, I included burpees and crawling, jogging. You can do whatever you want. If you want to warm up with, you know, jumping jacks or, you know, like things like mountain climbers or squat thrusts, any other type of exercise, lunges, you know, some light variations of push-ups, like wall push-ups. Whatever you want to do is good. Generally speaking, you do want to do a little bit of mobility work with all of the joints that you're going to use. So for body weight training in particular, and you're doing a lot of upper body work with the body weight exercises, you want to throw in some wrist circles both ways, some shoulder circles around, forward, around, back, making sure your arms go forward and back, getting in all various ranges of motion. Scapular circles can be effective as well. All things like this, same for the back and the lower body as well. You can do some calf raises, ankle circles, some knee movements, some hip movement. Basically, a lot of different things in order to warm the body up and get it ready for exercise. The main thing with warm-up is starting to move and get the tissues active. The cartilage in the joint actually starts to absorb water and kind of puff up, and it acts as a buffer for the joints moving and gliding and sliding across each other. So it is helpful for actually getting the tissues moving and warmed up effectively to actually do some type of warm up like that. Next, the reason why things like support holds and working up to German hang and skin the cats are in most beginner routines are because they tend to start to emphasize some straight arm work. So, support holds, working on the like parallel bars first and then eventually moving to rings help to work the connective tissue of the elbows and shoulders, get it paired. Similarly with German hang, which is going over backwards on the rings and with your arms behind you like this, get a good shoulder stretch and then coming out of it, warming up all the muscles pretty much around the shoulder area. Then you can do some positional drills, for example. Some of the more common ones are things like your planks, side planks, where you're facing the side and orienting your body more to the side, and then hollow and arch holds. You can also do these like hang from a bar or hang from rings. The main reason why these are in is because the difficulty of body weight exercises is inherently tied to your body position. So like if you are doing a push-up and you're, piking your hips or hollowing your body, rounding it, or doing an arch with your hips sagging, this can make the exercise easier, and in some exercises, it also can increase potential injury risk. And so maintaining the correct body positions and understanding the correct body positions with positional drills, just getting used to them, is a good idea for untrained beginners. Now, these exercises, all of them in the warm-up, definitely should not be taken to failure. If you're just exhausting yourself trying to do these things in the warm-up, then your workout is not going to be as effective. So when you see things like 30 to 60 second plank, I forgot the S in that, and same with the crawling. Basically any of them where it's aiming for like 30 to 60 seconds where you're holding it, just break it up into as many sets as possible. You don't want to be taking it to failure where you can't hold it anymore because that's going to pre-exhaust you for your workouts. All right, so getting into the skill work, one common recommendation, especially if one of your goals is handstand, is to start working handstand against the wall. Usually, a certain amount of time in the beginning is a good amount. So, 5 to 10 minutes, for example, is a commonly recommended use of time for handstands in the beginning. So, basically, kicking up with your back to the wall, getting comfortable with that, and then working towards getting your chest to the wall handstand, is one of the big things you want to do. And obviously, the wrists might need a little more prep than just wrist circles. So, some specific wrist exercises on the ground, some wrist stretching, and then mobility work against the ground where you're just starting to put weight on them in all directions is a good idea. Generally speaking, obviously, body weight training is not the only sport out there that has skill work. So, if your sport is football, basketball, or any type of ball sport, or any non-ball sport, you can do some skill-related training in here before your workouts. So this is usually why, like for gymnastics, you would do your event training. So like your ring swinging, your parallel bars, your skill work on vault and floor exercise before you do your strength work at the end, because you don't want to do your strength work and fatigue yourself, so you have less good practice with your exercises. At the end, you want to do your skill stuff first and then your strength at the end. Same with all the other sports and many more I didn't mention as well. In general, for like the handstands, I almost forgot. For the handstands, generally also not to failure. The basic goal is to get quality practice upside down, starting to learn the body positions and learning how to balance it with your forearms and keeping a perfectly straight body. And so you want to go not to failure, maybe about 50, 60, 70% of your max hold time, then come down and then rest a little bit that is adequate till you're feeling full again. So it might be a minute or two because you're not going to failure. And then kick back up, try to get some more practice, and then come down. So anywhere between about to 7, maybe up to 10 sets in within this range is good. And just getting used to it. And then obviously the skill work can expand over time as you get more experienced. All right, so strength work, generally, as we talked about before, we're generally dividing things into upper body pull, upper push, legs, and core as our four main areas to work. This is generally why most splits also deviate along these lines of having, you know, like a pull or back and buys day, a push or tries and chest day, and so on. So you have each of these categories. For us, we're doing a full body routine. So within the pull, we have your jumping pull-ups and ring rows, vertical and horizontal pull. With our push, we have dips and push-ups, also vertical and horizontal. Legs, we generally have a squat type motion, which is more legs, and then sort of a hip hinge with like a step up. Could be deadlift if you use barbells or maybe like shrimp squat. For core, you generally want at least one anterior and one posterior core. So in this case, we have our L-sits and our reverse hyperextensions. So in general, for the exercises, as I mentioned, or I didn't mention, but I am going over the three sets or 3x5 with the arrow to 15. Means you're generally going to work from about the 5 repetition range, and then over time you're going to progress it to 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and so on to about the 15 rep range. And for the specific eccentrics where you're doing like jumping pull-ups, you're going to jump up to the top and slowly lower. It's on a 5-0-x-0 tempo where the beginning number is the eccentric time. So you're lowering slow 5 seconds. For the 1-0-x-0, for like the ring rows and push-ups, it's the 1 second slow but controlled eccentric, and then accelerating through the motion with the row as fast as possible. That is the general best tempo for strength and hypertrophy. And then also for like the core and the reverse hypers, generally higher reps are fine here. The L-sits, you don't want to go to failure with the initial set, so break it up into as many sets as need. So, you know, like 3 sets of 20 seconds or 4 sets of 15 and so on. So in general, if you're going close to failure or at least within 1 to 2 reps in reserve to start, 3 minutes rest between all exercises is good. If you need to shorten the workout time, you can pair exercises such as like the upper body ones, like push-ups with the leg ones such as squats and rest 1.5 minutes in between those. So you have 3 minutes between your sets of push-ups with the push-ups, 1.5 minutes rest, squats, 1.5 minutes rest, push-ups, and repeat. You have 3 minutes between the push-ups, 3 minutes between the squats, and so on. All right, so for prehab, isolation, flexibility, and cooldown, again, this is the generalized routine. If your wrists were ailing, you could add in some rice bucket to help to strengthen the muscles of the forearms and get the wrists conditioned. Same with the biceps, with working with the support holds, the rows, and the pull-ups. The biceps need a little bit of work. You can also add in some bicep curls. Similarly, if you're aiming for some more hypertrophy, you can do that as well as having the isolation exercise there. For flexibility, working the German hang. So this is different between the German hang in the beginning where you're doing it more for mobility and warm-up. Here, you would just hold it a longer time and allow yourself to relax into the bottom of the stretch. Same thing with back bridges. If you have other goals here, you can add them, such as, you know, like working towards your straddle pancake or your pike stretch or your splits, or if you're shoulders aren't opening all the way for your handstands, for example, doing things like the butcher block stretch or other various stretches to make sure you have the adequate range of motion for your skill training and your bodyweight exercises. Finally, cool down, deep breathing at the end, just to kind of reset the sympathetic nervous system to more parasympathetic, and then also eating afterwards can help do that as well. So very simple prehab iso flexibility cooldown type thing. You can always add a little bit more. You can, and then also if you lack time, you can always shift this to maybe the off days. Like if you have a whole comprehensive flexibility routine, you can shift it to the off days, because doing like 10, 15 stretches, if you really wanted all of that for like all the upper body and all the lower body, some for each joint, doing that after a strength workout can make things go on for like, you know, 2, 2.5 hours. So you always have the option to kind of shift things with this skill and also the prehab isolation flexibility cooldown to potential off days as well. All right, so getting into the implementation and progression. For progression and leveling up, the main thing is to basically use the easiest progressions in order to progress. So linear progression, that's basically the Mark Ripito add weight to the barbell. But for us, we can add weight by adding a weight vest or backpack, something like that, or make exercises harder. In a different way, or go to the next harder exercise and make it easier with the band. Easy way to do that. You can progress like that if you want. Weighted calisthenics or weighted body weight exercises are all about just loading on the body weight onto yourself with, you know, a dip belt or a pull-up belt or a weighted vest and progressing like that. That is a good way to do things. Similarly, linear repetition progression, moving up from the lower reps, building up, so 3 sets of 5, 3 sets of 6, and so on up to 15, then moving to the next progression. Very good. Eccentrics, like the jumping pull-ups and the dips, generally speaking, you can't do 5 seconds with the 5-0-x-0 tempo on the lower. You know, start with 2 to 3, build up to 5, work your way up to, you know, about 7 to 10 second eccentrics. And once you can do a couple of those in the row, usually you're able to do the full pull up or dip. So you can work up the eccentrics like that to make sure you can do a concentric in the future. Isometrics, you can increase your hold time. So if you're doing something like your support holds or frog stand for planche, you can increase the time. Say you're doing 10 seconds, work towards 11, 12, 13, and so on. There's also a lot of other of the simple intra and inter-exercise progressions I mentioned in the methods of progression, which is video 10 or chapter 10 in the book. So if you want to know some more of those to continue to progress, if these aren't working effectively, you can just check out that video and chapter. So, progression continued. Moving on to new progression. Progressions, generally speaking, it's very easy. Once you get to about 15 reps with the current progression, it's fairly easy to move to the next progression. You'll usually find you can do at least 1 to 2, if not 3, 4, 5 reps of the next progression. The most of the progressions in level 1 to 5 of the chart are actually pretty close together. So once you're able to hit that 10 to 15 rep range, you're usually able to do several of the next progression. Usually, once you get to like level 7, 8, 9 on the charts, that's when there's more of a gap between progressions. And so you might need to have the inter-exercise progressions to help you bridge the gap, like hybrid sets where you do one of the next progression and then do eccentrics, for example, or add reps of the next progression all in the same set. So for isometric focus, you can start to work towards your back levers, your front levers, and planche. Similarly, with muscle ups, rows, and handstand push-ups to supplement those. If you're more interested in all-around strength, and you do have isometric priority as one of yours, but you also want to add you know, a good amount of muscle mass and be proficient with movements, then generally I tend to recommend going from push-ups into pseudo planche push-ups, dips into weighted dips or rings, ring dips or handstand push-ups, pull-ups working towards weighted pull-ups or one-arm chin-ups, and rows working towards one-arm rows or front level rows. These types of movements tend to have the best transference to most other exercises. So someone who is able to Do really heavy weighted pull-ups or one-arm chins is usually able to do a front lever or at least get pretty close to it. And similarly with a back lever, maybe not supinated but pronated. So if you are want the best kind of all-around strength, these are generally the movements that you want to work because they have the best transference to most other exercises in the long run. All right, so finally, common setbacks. For untrained beginners, usually routine balance is the biggest issue. So if you have some posture, problematic posture issues, or you've been training like bro splits, where you've been emphasizing, the chest and the biceps too much, generally speaking, just getting into a regular routine balance with the equal amounts of push and pull will help get you there. But sometimes you need to drop a pushing and maybe add an extra pulling to help you kind of get back into more even pushing pulling mode of action. So keep that in mind. Generally speaking, length of routine, I've mentioned this in some of the previous slides, but you can pair sets to save time. But also for beginners, you don't necessarily need three sets to progress optimally. Some people do better with one or two, especially if they're untrained, just getting started. And so, shortening the length of the routine by doing less sets but still progressing fairly effectively can do that by reducing the sets as well. I find that some people, especially the older populations, like I talked about in video six or chapter six, I believe, tend to have more recovery issues. And so, like a full body routine with two exercises and three sets can be too much for some people to start. And so, reducing the one to two sets as the primary progression decreases the length of the routine. And it also helps people to progress effectively without having to go to a split or only doing 2 days a week training. So, it is better to have that full body at less volume if you can't handle the full amount of two sets of three exercises per muscle group. Another common setback is your strength progression. Generally speaking, if there's no progress in about 2 to 3 weeks, change up your progression. Normally, beginners, especially untrained beginners, will be able to make progress from workout to workout. And what that means is you'll be able to progress on, say, your push-ups and your dips each workout. It's also common to only progress on one exercise. So, like, if dips were earlier in the workout, you might progress on dips, but then you might not progress on push-ups later because of the accumulated fatigue of the workout. And so, if you're not making any progress with all of your exercises, then it may be time to change progressions or even take a deload if you're feeling overly fatigued, especially if you have other outside life stresses as well, like poor sleep, nutrition, or stress. It's also common for beginners, especially untrained beginners, to have paralysis by analysis. I know that the book and this video series is an enormous amount of information to take in. And so the main thing is to just get started. You don't want perfect to be the enemy of good. In most cases, no one knows what even perfect looks like for really anybody in particular. Like, if you have no experience understanding how your body responds to exercise, how can you make a perfect routine? It's impossible. Even in professional athletes, who their abilities and you have maybe years of data on how they respond to different various programs, frequency of exercises, volume, and intensity, you still can have issues where things are getting thrown into the mix, like overuse injuries, poor recovery because they slept bad one night because their kid or family had an emergency. So there's also these tons of different life factors that can come in and throw things off. So there's really no one perfect routine. You just want to have something simple, get started, and then start tracking how your body responds to things. And that will allow you to get more data to kind of hone in on what tends to work best for you. So don't get stuck analyzing things. Get started, even if it's really something simple, such as, like one push, one pull, one legs, one core, anterior and one posterior. Good enough to start, then you can always add more if you need it. Same with any of like the simple beginner routines that I've covered before. Just get started. If it feels like too much, dial back the sets a little bit. But just get started and see how your body responds. So another common setback is routine mania, and this is for my exercise ADHD people out there. You tend to want to stick with the routine for like 4 weeks, see some progress, but then you want to routine hop. Obviously, the best way to progress is going to be continuing on that same routine and progressing. If you need some variety, make sure that your routine structure suits that. So if full body is too boring for you, maybe do a 2 day split. Can be similarly effective or maybe just a little less effective. Gives you some of the variety you need, but also allows you to keep progressing with these specific exercises to continue to get stronger and bigger. So you can always switch up your goals and modify your routines a little bit, but you don't want to tweak too many things, especially if things are working. You'll find out as you get more towards intermediate, advanced, and elite that, the gains come slower, the fatigue is higher, and so you want to eke out these gains effectively as you can, especially in the beginning. Finally, the last major common setback is overuse injuries, especially for entry and beginners who have never really done exercise before. Just pay close attention to any type of connective tissue. So if you have sore shoulders and it's not really muscle, it's feeling a little bit deeper. If your biceps tendon or your common flexor tendon, if your tendons are starting to feel sore or your joints are starting to feel achy, and it's not regular muscle soreness, which is fine, like in your chest, biceps, triceps, etc., then make sure that you dial back your exercises so you can go to a previous progression and just do lighter for a few days up to a week, or take a deload at that time if you're also feeling fatigued. Just back off, allow the tissues to reset themselves. Once you start to feel like that soreness, that's kind of the start of the overuse injury process. And so working through that soreness to where it devolves into pain is usually going to cause the progression of an overuse injury into like full-blown tendinopathy, where you may have to do rehab for several weeks to several months to get back to where you were. So if we catch things early and back off, generally at most you've lost is a week for the most part. Whereas if you let these things continue to progress and fester, or maybe that's not the best term, but you kind of get the point where you're allowing the injury to progress into something more serious, and you might have to rehab for several weeks or several months. Don't want it to get there. So obviously there can be more common setbacks for untrained beginners, but these are the major ones that you'll encounter. So just keep them in mind when you're starting to make your routine as an untrained beginner or using a beginner routine. These are kind of the things you want to look for. And we'll get into the trained beginner routine progression in the next part of the series.